In general, Ukraine is a fantastic country and it has a wonderful future ahead, I'm convinced. And also the changes since 2014 have been very, very positive to have this will to join the European Union, to be united under European law. It's very, very positive. And also the last 3 years have seen wonderful improvements in many aspects already. But it's not so easy to change a country. It's not a 2-3 years process. We have to think in decades. And the experience of Europeans of tax reform, which is on my movement, where I'm the president, is that especially in Central Europe, it was very successful. In Southeastern Europe, it takes time, but it was also very successful. And in Ukraine, it will be also very successful. What is needed in the fight of anti-corruption is the cooperation with the European Union. This is very important. And for example, in Southeastern Europe, we have created our own agency to make a regional exchange of experience how anti-corruption can best be fought. Yeah? Because no country can do that alone. It's impossible for the political elite to be so courageous to basically take itself off these opportunities alone. So it can only happen in the regional context and only with the help of the European Union. So we have our own regional organization. It's called Regional Anti-Corruption Agency, and Ukraine should join that. And that would be one big step forward. And the second proposal is, I think, also when it comes to reforming the justice system, at the moment Ukraine and the EU were only ready for a cooperation platform and advisory platform. In Kosovo, for example, where I worked before, it was possible to have an executive mandate for the EU mission in the rule of law. It's called ILEX. And I think also Ukraine should think if it's not better to share some of the sovereignty already, because European Union is very much about sharing sovereignty. This is your ultimate goal. So also in the rule of law and in the issue of who is controlling the prosecutor, to have it only the parliament and the prosecutor or the president, yeah, in this very tight history of networks between all the personalities, yeah, it's very hard to change that. And what I think is necessary is to have an executive mandate of the European Union Advisory Mission. And this is also really co-responsibility with Ukraine in the area of rule of law. It's not easy, I understand, because you're very sensitive in the issues of sovereignty and independence. But it's one vital point to understand. When you join the European Union, you are no longer a sovereign Ukraine. You are a member state of a supranational European Union. And this pooling of sovereignty has been very, very important. And it's a big shock in a way, but this has to be done. I think the earlier the better, to be explained to the people and to the political elite that in many aspects, for example, Austria, when I can say that in 95, it was very, very difficult to accept for the political elite that somebody from the competition authority of the European Union comes and checks the banking market, industry market, energy market, and we have to comply. There's no alternative. And the same process, I think, is necessary for Ukraine now to really have cooperation and also co-decision making already in the important point of anti-corruption, because alone Ukraine will not be able to do that. Look, in general, that's very positive, because Eastern Partnership is a success. Also Eastern Chip Plus is a success. But I think it's good, but it's not good enough. We, as a European Union, have to be the framework to stabilize the Eastern Partnership countries. And this can only be done, the stability, when we promise and we give the green light for full membership of Ukraine, Georgia and Moldova and the countries who want in the region, and that they can join the European Union completely. What the Parliament has mentioned is very, very positive, you know, joining the EU Customs Union, joining potentially Schengen and making sector integrations. It's the next big step, obviously, because there's also some countries in the European Union who are a little bit afraid of Russia, or very afraid of Russia, or have business ties with the Russian leadership. And you know, there's also some where the convincing case of Ukrainian reforms after 2014 has not completely arrived, yeah? Because, you know, maybe they didn't talk enough about it, was not enough convention. So it's really still an ongoing struggle inside the European Union. to give a green light for Ukraine to join, because it will also mean a lot of changes in the European Union. Ukraine is not a country like Estonia. It's not a 2 million country. It's a 40 million country. It has a lot of land. It is, you know, it's very expensive. Yeah? It's not a normal club, the European Union, like a golf club. You pay a membership fee and you are there. Thank you. Yeah? No, that means hundreds of billions of euros of transfers in the future decades to come to Ukraine to bring this country on the levels of which we and the European Union think is appropriate in agriculture, in municipal services, in infrastructure. This is the most expensive project we have undertaken in the last 20 years to bring Ukraine in. So understand as well that a lot of people in the budget committees in the European Parliament say, how much will that cost? Yeah, it's not so easy. Yeah, because I understand here everybody in Ukraine thinks, oh, we go and we are a rich country potentially, we will be rich together, and that's it. But you know, that will be for 50 years. Yeah, the thing is, if you now for the next years, it will be an enormous investment of the European member states, who ultimately give the budget for the European Union, to invest in Ukraine in terms of infrastructure, agriculture, municipal services, and all these things the EU is doing. So, you know, we have to be a bit more ambitious. That means Ukraine has, in the last year especially, not been very ambitious. Yeah? You have done reforms, yes, very good, but I don't want to be provocative, but it was a bit of luxury reforms. You know, education, health, maybe cannot be seen as luxury. Yeah? But, you know, at this stage of development, to put so much money in pavements in Kiev, yeah, and new asphalts, yeah, the education law, the health law, you know, these are all very important for the people. I don't want to talk negatively about it. Yeah? But, you know, the real important things are the big step forward in bringing the economic system of Ukraine to normal standards in the land market, capital market, labor market. You still have a lot of tradition of the Soviet Union in your hearts, yeah? This is, and in your heads. It's very difficult to overcome that, I understand, because of this 100 terrible years. Yeah? But as long as you think you can organize land, labor, and capital like you do today, you know, it's very difficult for us who are very pro-Ukrainian in the European Union to say, this is really ready, this country. Yeah? You have to give the yes to EU perspective. Yeah? Because then they say, ah, you know, they have human rights abuses, like this land moratorium. Yeah? And then you, yes, unfortunately, yeah. And, you know, what I want to say is, it's very good what is happening at the Eastern Partnership debate this week. And I'm totally in favor of the ERP plus. But, you know, the European Union and Ukraine to be really very seriously in the next months, in the next important months, because in the next half year, there is a majority in the Ukrainian parliament for the decisive reforms which are needed. And they were mentioned by the IMF, by the World Bank, by the EU, by everybody who is co-financing and really helping a lot now. And, you know, with a little bit of a push and a little bit of a drive to focus on the real important laws, yeah, like, again, the economy is the key in competition as well, for example, in state subsidies, in the energy market. Yeah, you are a little bit, you know, a little bit fast happy with yourself, you know. You do some things, yeah, and you think it's wonderful compared to the 20 lost years you had, yeah. But when you see the drive which the Southeastern European reform countries after the war, until 2000, we had the wars in the Balkans, and then, you know, they were much more desperate and they had to go much more faster. And also Georgia, for example, much faster reforms. Ukraine, you do things and then you are already quite, you know, yeah. I understand it, you know, because you are a big country, so the elite, yeah, is already very, very developed, yeah. The center is very developed, yeah. But, you know, you have not really completely transformed in a European direction in the key essential issues, and they are not very complicated to do ultimately. And you have majorities in the parliament now for education law, for health law, so why not to have it as well for a change in the tax code? Very important for our movement, obviously, reducing the tax rates to 10%, like Georgia, like Kosovo, like Macedonia, like Bulgaria, like Hungary has 9%, for example, now is in the EU. And also to make it more simple, the tax code, obviously. And these, I think, are the essential issues which can be done until the summer 2018. And, you know, it will be a much more successful country. And then, you know, the point will come when you are ready for the EU application. And then, you know, send it, and you know, you will have a lot of partners, and the arguments will be good. But this homework here, Ukraine still has to make.
And as for Georgia, as to EU?
Look, you know, we have 6 countries in the Eastern Partnership. Yeah, 3 of them have the will and the, you know, that's the most important thing. Does the nation want to join the European Union and NATO? This is connected. And you know, Georgia, Moldova and Ukraine, they in principle, they have expressed it, most of all, clearly Ukraine, that they want. Yeah? And so they are one group. In Armenia, Azerbaijan and Belarus, they have other different policy priorities we can discuss afterwards. But these 3 countries, we think, are one group and they should get a green light from the European Union for membership this week best. And that would be the best format. If that's not possible at this summit, there will be a summit next year as well. And you know, the idea would be to turn them from partners into potential candidate countries. Yeah? This is the status of Kosovo and of Bosnia at the moment in the list of EU membership applications. Yeah? And this would be the proposal for 2018. Is it be doable? Absolutely. And you have seen there is a lot of support already with the DCFTA, which was also with Georgia, and also there is with visa liberalization. By the way, congratulations, it was a big step. You see, the readiness of the European Union for sector integration of Georgia and Ukraine, Moldova is very, very strong. We have actually achieved a lot this year, so we can be very happy in all the aspects. But nevertheless, the next big step is definitely the green light for a potential EU candidate status agreed by the Council in 2018. Mm-hmm. Look, it's very terrible and I'm very sorry. It's a Russian aggression and, you know, I feel the pain. I personally worked a long time in Albania, Kosovo after the war. It's very, very traumatic and tragic what is done by the Russian Federation to so intensively lead and support the rebellion against the European status quo post-war. So I'm very sorry. What is needed, I think, as I have said already, we as Europeans for Tax Reform advocate very strongly that the Ukrainian authorities see the success models of what was done in the 90s in the Balkans in terms of peacemaking. And this is the same model for Donbas and Crimea. We advocate already since 1 year, since March 2017, that there will be UN peace missions established in the whole territory of Donbas and of Crimea, and 2 different missions with the role model of the 1244 UN mission for UNMIK, it was called, the United Mission in Kosovo. So there will be the UN in charge of administering, securing and developing of this territory. And the status will be decided in 10 years after the mission was completed, in whatever 15 years after a cooling off period, of the re-establishment of the rule of law, of political and democratic freedom, and then there will be a decision made. Always clearly, I have to say, because there is this concerns, clearly that in the international law doesn't allow these annexations to be rewarded politically, so there is no options for Donbas to join the Russian Federation or for Crimea. These are part of Ukraine, obviously, and they will be handed over. Similar, maybe a good case is the reintegration of the Eastern German states into the German state after the end of communism. And this will come by time, but at the moment it's, I think, the best for the people there living and for the political system of Ukraine and for Russians as well, to be honest. Yeah? Nobody in Russia wants this war to go on, go on, go on. It's only a small clique in the Kremlin which thinks that it is profitable for them. But I think if you're honestly speaking, and then most of the people also in the Russian Federation will want peace in Europe and will have not to have to pay these enormous costs of that war and of the and afterwards the reconstruction. So the best is that the UN takes over in Crimea and in Donbas. Look, he's a great hero for everybody who loves transformation success stories. What he done in Georgia is obviously a first-class case of fighting corruption, of improving a country from the real misery towards a very, very good development, now rewarded by the European Union with visa liberalization, DCFTA, and hopefully also a future in the European Union. Imagine that. you know, many people in Europe probably don't even really can point Georgia on the map. Caucasus is far. So he was really the man who made it possible by his transformation success that people now know Georgia, people respect it, and it's a possibility. And we very much hope that one day Georgia will be member of the EU, member of NATO, and all these things. Look, he has also done great things in Ukraine. But we in generally, we are a little bit, you know, I also a little bit disappointed by this current confrontation between President Poroshenko and President Jakubowicz, because, you know, the only one profiting can be the opponents of the European Union and of a European Ukraine. Because we have thought it would be better there will be some kind of cooperation platform. Yeah? And I can only call on all the personalities who are interested in the success of European integration of Ukraine to find an understanding, a consensus, and some kind of mutual respect in dealing with each other. Even when it's a competitive world, yeah, they are competing for the one and the same position, I understand that. But nevertheless, to have a respectful and serious approach to each other and not to somehow escalate this confrontation in the coming year towards the presidential elections of Ukraine would be very good. You know, who will be the president of Ukraine? Ultimately, you know, we as Europeans, this is really not our issue in so much. It's a question of preferences of the voters of Ukraine. And we hope just that the pro-European, and we are convinced that the pro-European direction of Ukraine continues. And it will be a real pillar of stability, growth, success of this part of the future European Union where Ukraine should be part of. That in the Balkans, in Southeastern Europe, Montenegro and Kosovo, and they have unilaterally introduced the euro already, quite a long time already, first the mark and later the euro in 2001 when the euro was created. So it's totally doable, it was done. It's not very popular with the European Central Bank, and that's true, and some of the member states will be against that as well. But I'm actually in favor of introducing the euro as well in Macedonia, in Albania, in Serbia, in Bosnia, and also in Moldova and also in Ukraine. And if the Georgians want, why not? Yeah? Because it's the ultimate expression of European unity, yeah? To use one currency. Yeah? And the currency is open for everybody to use it. And why not to use it in Ukraine as well? The experience of the hryvnia, you know, I understand a lot of people have a lot of patriotic pride in their own currency, and also we Austrians, we love the shillings, and especially the Germans love the mark. Yeah? But ultimately, it's much more cheaper to have one currency in a common market, yeah? Because you don't need to exchange, you have less risks. Yeah? And, you know, my best argument is like this. Yeah? It's a question, does a political elite of a country really have the capacity to deal seriously with the currency? Because the currency is always a big temptation. You can devalue it, you can inflate it, you can abuse it a lot, and you know, you somehow don't make the real reforms, like I have said in the beginning, and it's the most important point I want to make here. The capital market, the labor market, and the land market. Yeah? For example, you don't do these reforms. But what you do is you deflate your currency. Yeah? You decrease the value. So basically, that's a rather easy way. So basically, everybody has to pay the cost of transformation. Yeah? And you don't have to vote in the parliament on the key issues, which are painful because you know you have always a lot of vested interests. Yeah? So having a currency like the EU, which like the euro, it takes away the power to decrease your currency. So what I say is, yeah, for Ukraine to do it is a courageous step. You know, of course, you have a lot of patriotism behind your currency, and you have a lot of people, like in the central bank, who maybe don't want this because they say, oh, more people, it's more risk, and you know, another country with loose monetary policy, with loose, with high debts and high risk, like Greece, is not so nice. But I never said that you should join the Eurozone because that's 50 years away. Yeah? You will not sit in the European Central Bank. You will not have a vote. Yeah? It's just a unilateral declaration that you swap your currency from the hryvnia to the euro. And it's the most powerful expression you can make that you really want to be in the European Union. And it's a bit gate crashing, true. But I ask myself what other forms of policy options you have available at the current political climate and situation to really speed up. And contrary to Southeastern Europe, you have a very powerful enemy in the East, which is ready to use force and is able to use force. And it's really, really, in a way, with nuclear arms and with this military capacity, and proven already twice in Georgia and in Ukraine, and to an extent in Moldova, that he is absolutely ready to interfere. So I don't know what time to waste. Yeah. So introducing the euro, he's of course courageous, but it's not a risky undertaking because it was done now in many, many countries of Eastern Europe. It's now in the Baltic countries already. It's in most of the countries, and doing it fast, decisively, and with conviction, and doing it in a way, surprisingly, I think would be the best policy option to make clear to everybody in the world where you belong to, and it can also not be reversed. Imagine, in 2019 comes another president like Yanukovych, yeah, has some platform, whatever, I don't want to say that this is happening. But it was already that we were with big hopes in the orange times, yeah, and we thought everything is now fixed for the future of European Ukraine, and it didn't happen like this. Yeah. I don't say that this is a real scenario, but let's see. I think the irreversibility of the Ukrainian westward integration, yeah, cannot be achieved so easily with EU and NATO integration because, and that was the strategy of Putin, he has occupied Crimea and Donbass, so it's more difficult with NATO integration at the moment, yeah, because of the ongoing war. That's of course a challenge. Yeah. The euro is not hindered by that, and Mr. Putin has already introduced the ruble in Crimea and in Donbass, as far as I'm informed, so why not do the euro in the free Ukraine?